first of all, of course, thank you very much. I think it's a quite exciting time for working in remote sensing, especially with all the new technology coming up, all the data accessibility, programs like Copernicus from the ESA, giving us access to a vast amount of data sets, which we hopefully can manage to utilize in a sensible way. So I think these types of sessions definitely make a lot of sense. First of all, the region we're in, this is northwest Pisidia. It's about 150 kilometers north of Antalya in Turkey. It's a part of the Taurus Mountain. And the general research question we are dealing with, not the Turkish colleagues, but we're more in the Bronze Age time, is the transition between the Middle Bronze Age, the Late Bronze Age, the Dark Ages. Where are the Late Bronze Age sites? They are kind of gone. The pottery situation is fairly difficult. There are different hypotheses about why the Late Bronze Age sites are difficult to find. Either they moved to the mountains, and in the mountains, of course, it's not necessarily very easy to find sites. There, as I said, a lot of different theses. One of them also being possibly that we just don't know where these sites are, just because the general research hasn't been conducted enough. We're focusing mainly on two types of sites. The one type of site are hilltop settlements. The hilltop settlements in this region are fairly difficult to locate. On the one hand, of course, with field surveys, because just walking up a 1,000 meter high mountain to see if something's up there is, of course, not really feasible on a large scale. On the other hand, those hilltop settlements usually have fairly little visible architecture, so we don't have like big wall constructions or anything like that, but mainly they are characterized by terraces. So they have like small terraces, which in many different data sets aren't really very well visible. The other types of sites we're dealing with are, I don't want to really even call them tells, because they're tiny. Those are more settlement mounds, in Turkish, they are fairly badly preserved due to the agricultural work. So all the hayeks we know in that region are maybe 1, 2, 3 meters high, gently sloped. So even if you're on the field survey, they're partially difficult to locate due to all the agricultural work, the fruit trees that are growing there, and so on and so forth. So part of my research work is to document a couple of the well-known sites to try to characterize certain spectral and topographic features to see if those are, again, accessible through other remote sensing platforms, to maybe then just generalize the landscape and see potential sites, for example, within the mountain range, that one can deliberately go to those places and not kind of look around in the wild. So one of the sites where we have some of the architectural features, but they're Hellenistic, due to the pottery, the little bit of pottery we have, we think it might have a Bronze Age precessor, is on the Mount of Kala Tepe. We have here this fortification wall running once around. And what one also can see fairly nicely is here these terraces sloping down. I'll get to that again a little bit later. It seemed, at least this morning, that there was generally a little bit of interest in methods about UAVs and things like that. I actually wasn't planning to go into that topic, but it's actually kind of fun to fly on hilltop settlements, because generally UAVs use barometric heights. So meaning my starting point is my zero altitude, and I say I want to fly 60 meters high, which of course is a little bit difficult if you have a fairly steep slope, so you have to make sure that your starting point doesn't just like make the copter fly into the mountain. And one disadvantage of this method, and this was my first try on a hilltop settlement, is that I just started from below, flew a quadrant, then I went a little bit further up, flew another quadrant, is that one has a very strong, varying spatial resolution within the images. Also the overlap is varying, because in the lower part, of course, I have a high overlap, a little spatial resolution, while in the upper parts I'm flying closer to the ground, so my overlap is less while my resolution is higher. So that, of course, is regarding the data quality a little bit of a problem. The next site there, I had then the opportunity or the possibility to do a terrain-based flight, so meaning really following the terrain with the copter. This is Aaron the Tepe. Aaron the Tepe is characterized by no real visible architecture, except you can see them maybe here a little bit, these tiny terraces. Here it was kind of exciting because I had a flight or an altitude of 60 meters above ground. And standing on the top point here, I suddenly looked at my remote control and I had an altitude heading of minus 140 meters because the copter was over here, and since he was following the terrain, he suddenly was 140 meters below me, which was of course a little bit of a challenge. But nonetheless, in this case, it's 8,000 images, 36 megapixels, average accuracy of 5 centimeters, 2.2 billion points, and I think this is a good base for further analysis of different features and as a comparison, or I guess ground truth data to other topographic data sets. Another site, or the other I was talking about, those the settlement mounds, as you can see, it's nothing comparable to parts of Turkey, Syria. You might, maybe not even on this beamer, but you might see a little bit of a shadow over here, but hardly. That's of course a little bit of a problem, especially if you're in the field itself. Some of these show up in multispectral images fairly well. For example, in the Sentinel-2 data, especially through the time, one can actually map these fairly well. Of course, the Sentinel-2 data with its 10 meter, like with the highest resolution of 10 meters per pixel, is an indicator of the site, but you can't really grasp the site in itself. We have a third type of site. This is like a mix between the two. We have in the valley a natural hill on which the settlement is, but this one is one of those typical ones that have been built by later periods, built over the earlier period. So it's also kind of difficult there to see where the Bronze Age parts are. Here, this is actually a fairly big data set, just to get into the technical stuff a little bit. We have here about 15,000 images. I was fortunate enough to have a clustering processor. Like I could have 23 computers that calculated in parallel. So it took 2 days to generate here about 3 billion points. Again, with the spatial accuracy, with about, it was, I think, 70 ground control points, 30 as reference points, 30, 35 as control points. Average accuracy, again, around 5 centimeters, spread across an area of 1.5 by 1.2 kilometers. One of the major things for our research is the access to large-scale topographic data. So if we want to locate a vast majority of different types of sites, we now have the possibility to do this on a really big scale. Here's one nice example of the data sets that we got from the German Aerospace Center. That's the TanDEM-X. I guess all of you heard probably of it. And here you just see a nice visual comparison of the Höyük that I showed you before. That's this little dot here, which is very well visible in comparison to traditional SRTM. Astro GDM doesn't look much better than this. So this data set, of course, for us is really very, very valuable, and I can just really express my gratitude for being able to work with this type of data. Unfortunately, this data set itself doesn't enable us to capture the terraces. So just the resolution of 12 meters per pixel is too coarse. Therefore, I'm still kind of hoping and waiting. There's a second version supposed to come out with 6 meters per pixel. Alternatively, our plan is actually to use stereo imagery. For example, Airbus Pléiades has tri-stereo images, which should definitely have the accuracy and also the spatial resolution to capture those types of features. And again, these high resolution, highly accurate data sets would serve as a validation to see how well one can generate those kind of data sets to as a comparison. When we first started in Kale Tepe, that's the first site here, we kind of started with a topographic plan measured with traditional total station. I don't even want to show it just because it's like so basic. It just represents the general extent. We had a Quickbird standard 2A image. So some of the major features are very well visible. So you have the fortification wall running around. Here's the entrance area. These are all natural structures. And the whole general situation on this site was kind of complex because it's rising up, and one doesn't, it's very difficult to actually orient oneself, like find topographic features or anything like that. You see there's like a little bump here, a little bump there, but one doesn't really get a grasp for the site itself. So we had, of course, the hope through a geophysical survey to get like a glimpse of what's going on with all these bumps and things like that going on. Maybe somebody else can see more than I can see, but I don't really see that much. Unfortunately, it's probably the bedrock that's just the signal is too strong. But as I said, the interpretation, one can maybe see a little something here. There's some little features here and there, but nothing where one can say, oh, this is a building, that's a building. So of course, it was quite a surprise then in 2015 when we did our first UAV survey there to see suddenly all these fine topographic structures, which kind of definitely indicate anthropogenic or man-made features. The question was, okay, how can one now try to derive from these features something that's a little bit more, understandable? So my idea was, or not idea, but on the site itself, there are some stone features, I can't see it from here, where one can fairly well see that within these building structures, the vegetation definitely is a lot different than the surrounding area. So I was, of course, hoping that through different multispectral images, we could get the same effect in these areas. So here we have a Pléiades image, and as one can see just on the RGB channels already, there isn't that much to see. And even then doing it, unfortunately, didn't have the feature-based classification with me. Even with just this quick, unsupervised classification, there isn't that much going on. Similar with Worldview 3 datasets, one can kind of think a little bit in these areas that there's something greenish. Here again, I had to do just very quickly just an unsupervised classification, where again, in comparison to the topography, it's kind of difficult to see the difference between the two. In other areas, but we have, for example, in the terraces, here one can almost kind of get a grasp that something's going on in that area, so that's definitely something worth further investigation. Additionally, of course, to the whole UAV aspect, is just the problem that, especially when we have architecture, that all these features, of course, are lost because the aerial images don't have the right angle to capture the structures itself. So what we've done actually is that we've also scanned, 3D scanned the entire area. And it's quite often the question, oh, scanning versus image-based modeling, what's better, what's worse? I must say I like both of them, and I think the combination of the two can be definitely very productive in that sense. So in this case, next to the 3D scan, we did, of course, another photogrammetric survey, terrestrial in this case, and you can see, of course, one of the major problems with 3D scanning is you have to cover all the shadows, meaning like the scan shadows. So I have to reposition my scanner, and if you have fairly complex situations like this, we have a Leica scan station too. It's a very old one, it's 20 kilos, lugging that on a mountain and then trying to position yourself on all these stones to get every little shadow is, of course, fairly intense. On the other hand, for image-based modeling, taking pictures is also not very easy, climbing around the stones, of course, trying with a wide angle to get the images. So in this case, we combined both data sets. So we just did a deviation analysis between the two data sets. So we could hear the red parts are the parts that are captured via photogrammetry, but not via the laser scan. So of course, they have a high deviation. And based on this deviation value, we can then segment those parts from the photogrammetry and fill the laser scan. So we have a data combination between the two just to really get all those little cracks and things like that filled up. This is the extraction. And so after, of course, having the two data sets in one correlated system, we have, of course, also the possibility, I don't know how many people have worked with laser scanning. Laser scanning, quite often, unless you use an external camera, the image quality is fairly bad. And that's, of course, somewhat of a, I don't want to say a problem, but the small cameras within 3D scanners aren't comparable to modern SLRs, DSLRs with 36 megapixels or 42 megapixels. So one of the nice things one can do when one has these both data sets in one combined environment is that one uses then the high quality color imagery to map that onto the 3D scan, which quite often, not always, but quite often has a better geometric sense than the image-based modeling. It's debatable, I know, it depends a lot on the situation, but it's of course very difficult to take optimal images in this kind of situation, that you always have the right distance between two images in different directions and so forth. So here, it's just a nice way of combining the two data sets. Another additional opportunity to use this combination of these data sets is we have, of course, when we do the 3D scanning, you see most, or I'd say of the 3D scan we did there, probably 80% of the 3D scan was vegetation, like just grass. And of course, extracting the grass to get a nice topographic plan, plus also not filtering out the vertical surfaces was a, or is a challenge. And in this sense, here's a multi-scalar classification based on Brodo and Lake's work, absolutely recommendable. They already have also implementation in Cloud Compare. So if you have point clouds that you want to classify based on training classes, so you define different classes, and then he automatically classifies your entire point cloud, I can really just recommend it. Unfortunately, it doesn't work 100%, of course not. So additionally to these outliers, or as an additional factor, one can then also use the color imagery, and that's actually one of the parts where we now want to go in, we're planning to go a step further, is to mount a multispectral camera onto a 3D scanner, so we can map the multispectral output onto the point cloud of the 3D scanner to segment then the point cloud based on the multispectral data set. So we have each per X, Y, Z value, we have the RGB, and then also the different bands of the multispectral imaging. This is one of the results when all the vegetation is finally filtered and we only have our topographic or our architectural features. And one step further is then just having this in a combined environment. And that's actually something I can recommend in the session about immersive environments and so on and so forth. We have a VR headset here where we have an integration between this millimeter data of this entrance area, then the entire topographic site, and then additionally to that, the 80 by 80 kilometers TanDEM-X topography, plus everything is texture mapped with Sentinel-2 data. You can take a look at it, you can fly around in the area, you can do measurements, things like that. So it should actually be set up by my colleague by now. And with that, just a special thanks to the German Aerospace Center for the data. I must say I'm super happy. The European Space Agency and the Copernicus program also, thanks. And of course, Daniel from Cloud Compare, very nice guy. Thank you.